Thank you. Good evening. Good to see everybody. Hope you rowed your boat on in, and some of you look like you've been swimming before church and all that good stuff. I'm glad to see you. Glad to see who of you could float on in. We're still on vacation, but I never know quite what to do when we're in town. Do you go somewhere else and just slip in the? Do you come here and just slip in the back? I felt that would make Brother Aaron really nervous if I just slipped in the balcony and was spying on him tonight. So we just decided to come on in and be with you guys. We've had a good trip and a good time away, and so that's been real nice. Well, let's stand together, and we're going to sing, "I Am Resolved No Longer to Linger," and I hope that you've been resolved in your convictions, and let's sing it to the Lord.
I am resolved no longer.
Resolved to follow the Savior.
I am resolved to follow the Savior.
Thank you.
singing tonight. You may be seated. A couple of announcements very quickly. I mentioned it already. Be in prayer for the backpack giveaway. I think we have around 20 to 25 signed up for that. We'd love to see more. And again, just trying to do something a little different there. That's going to be on Monday, August the 10th. And so people will pull through the parking lot. We'll be able to give them the school supplies, give them the gospel, an invitation to the church, and that kind of thing. School is starting up on the 11th, so be in prayer for this year's school year. Let's continue to pray for our enrollment and just God's blessing on a good school year. That's starting on Tuesday, this coming Tuesday. August the 16th, Heartland Baptist Bible College will be here in the evening service singing for us. I got a quartet of young men. They're going to be singing. I think you'll really enjoy them, and so that's coming up. And then tonight, Aaron Strickland is going to preach. Aaron has been our intern this summer, and he attends Heartland Baptist Bible College. And that's been we've been glad to have him, but it's been a little bit of a challenge for him because, you know, he came and everything was shut down. I mean, he came here and we were still doing online services. And then when we opened back up, it wasn't quite normal. So he didn't get the full swing. He didn't get to experience Kids Crusade and some of the different things that we do in the summer. But we sure have enjoyed having him be here. And in fact, Sunday is going to be his last Sunday with us. And we've paid him a little bit throughout the summer, but I think Sunday night we'll try to take an offering for him just to be a blessing. And we'll take that offering and we'll send that directly to the school that will go help pay for his tuition and college costs. So anything that's given there would go right to that. But we just want to be a blessing to him and looking forward to hearing what God has laid on his heart as he speaks for us tonight. So before he comes and speaks, Olivia's going to sing. And so I trust that you'll enjoy her as she sings about the Lord. And then when she's finished, Aaron, you just come and preach, okay?
You are the one we adore. Appreciate that song. It's a good song. Love that song. If you'd open up your Bibles to Judges chapter number 16. Judges chapter number 16. I wasn't horribly nervous about preaching tonight. I mean, I was nervous, but then today I was outside working and I got a text from preacher and he said, "Oh, I'm going to be there tonight." And I was like, "Oh, now I can be nervous." So I almost would appreciate it if you just came in and didn't say anything, but because I've been stressing out for hours now. Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to preach tonight. I do not take it lightly. Every time I get open the Word of God, it's an honor and a privilege. If you would stand with me tonight, Judges chapter number 16, we're going to read verses number 27 through 30. Now the house was full of men and women, and the lords of the Philistines were there. And there were on the roof about 3,000 men and women that beheld while Samson made sport. And Samson called unto the Lord and said, "O Lord God, remember me, I pray thee, and strengthen me, I pray thee, only this once, O God, that I may be able, that I might at once be avenged of the Philistines for my two eyes." And Samson took hold of the two middle pillars upon which the house stood, and on which it was borne up, and of one of his right hand, and of the other with his left. And Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." And he bowed himself with all his might, and the house fell upon the lords and upon all the people, and there were therein so that the which he slew at his death were more than the which he slew in his life. The title of my message is "A Little Help Over Here." A little help over here. Let's pray and we'll get into the message. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for the day you've given to us. I just thank you for the opportunity to preach your word tonight. And just I'm humbled, and I thank you so much for the opportunity to be here this summer. And I just, for the things I've learned, and I just thank you so much for that. Fill me with your spirit, calm my nerves so that I could convey your word to these people. I just thank you for that. Bless this day, in Jesus' name, amen. I grew up, I grew up in Missouri, and we had about 10 acres of land. And with that, we had some cattle at some points. And so I consider myself a country boy, I guess. And so with that, you have to build fence, and you have to tear down fence. And with the process of building fence, you got to dig corner post holes, which is a big hole that you put the corner posts in. And so with that, you have a big corner post, which usually it's a 6-7 foot piece of, honestly, log that you put down in the hole, and it's usually pretty heavy. And when I was younger, me and my dad, we would be working on fence, and it was time to drop the post in the hole. And I haven't always been this big. I used to be a really short, chubby kid. And so I was like, you know what? I can get this. Dad went to go do something else, so I decided to get down, try to pick it up, and it got to the point, I was like, oh no, I can't do this. And at that point, I had to realize I needed help. So obviously the title of my message, "A Little Help Over Here," I was like, Dad, I need some help. It's kind of heavy. And so he then came over and helped me, and we were able to do that and get the fence built. I imagine Samson is kind of somewhat of the same position. He put himself in a position where he needed help. And most of us know the story of Samson, where he went to his parents. God went to his parents. If you look, turn back to Judges chapter number 13, verses 4 through 4 and 5. It says, "Now therefore beware, I pray thee, drink not wine nor strong drink, nor and eat not any unclean thing. For lo, thou shalt conceive and bear a son, and no razor shall come upon his head, for the child shall be a Nazarite unto God from the womb." So God specifically told Samson, set Samson apart to do great things for God. And Samson has had such potential, but we come down to the end of his life, and he was blind, he was in prison, he was mocked, and he put himself in this position, and he had to restore the help from God. So tonight, I'm gonna preach tonight for a few minutes the process to which we restore our help from God. The first point is to do that, we have to, unfortunately, to get help, we're going to have to be in a position to honestly fail. Like, we're going to be in a position, just like I was in the position of when I needed the help from my dad, I was in that position. I was sunk. I needed help. And Samson did that. He put himself in a position where he shouldn't have been, honestly. If you look back in verse number one, and then Samson went to Gaza, and there, and saw there an harlot, and went unto her. So you could just see, Samson's putting himself in a position he doesn't need to be in. Right? And we can look back in previous chapters where he went to his mom and dad and said, there's a woman, go get her for me. And he continually puts himself in positions that he doesn't need to be in. And then you can look in verse number four. And it came to pass afterward that he loved a woman in the valley of Sorek whose name was Delilah. And obviously when you say the name Delilah, first thing pops in your head is, oh no, she's crazy. And just like Jezebel, that's another name. It's like, oh, she's crazy. You know the story, how Delilah deceived him and was like, where do you get your strength from? You probably twirled her hair with her finger. But Samson, and you know the story. There was the seven green withs where he tie my hair up, tie me up with seven green withs. She goes, Samson, the Philistines are upon thee. And he went, and beat up everybody. And then she goes, you lied to me. And to me, I would think, what is she trying to figure out my strength? I would think, I need to get away from her. But again, Samson's put himself in a position where he puts his own wants and his own ambitions in front of what God wants for him. And then obviously the two other things, he finally says, she goes, Samson, do you not love me? And he goes, obviously I love you. It's my hair. Can you imagine my hair? It's gorgeous. Just shave it and my strength will be gone. And in that moment, Samson put himself in a position to which he failed. He failed in the position where God set him apart for what he wanted him to do. So he put himself in a position to fail. Secondly, he put himself in a position of humility. Delilah shaved his head and he said, the Philistines are upon thee, and he came up and was like an ordinary man. He didn't have any strength. He couldn't beat off the Philistines like he had done the previous three other times. He gotten to a point where he was useless. For what God set him apart for, he became useless. Samson was thrown into prison. His eyes were gouged out. Can you imagine that? And he was treated as an animal. He was put in the grind mills and was made to grind wheat and whatever needed to be done. can you imagine with me his thought process while he was going in circles day after day, him thinking, only if I would have understood and done what God wanted me to do. And you can maybe think, he goes, maybe if God will give me one more chance, I'll do what he wants me to do. so with that, he finally got to the point where he was like, you know what, God, I can't do this on my own. I need your help. Excuse me. So then comes the where we're at in the passage. The process of restoring that help that we need from God is, we fail. Unfortunately, we fail. Then we have to get to the point where we're like, okay, I can't do this on my own. Then lastly, we have to put ourselves in a position of asking. We can't just like, okay, I can't do this on my own and not do anything about it. We have to ask God for help. And just like he does in verse number 28, and you can imagine with me, and Samson called unto the Lord and said, O Lord God, remember me. I pray thee and strengthen me. I pray thee only this once, O God, that I may be at once avenged of the Philistines for my two eyes. You can imagine as the lad pulls him into the big area, and there's people everywhere. And people are laughing at him. He goes, ha-ha, Samson, you're now we're making sport of you. We're making fun of you. You're nothing to us now. Where in the previous chapter, he killed 1,000 Philistines with the jawbone of a donkey. Now you are nothing. So he had to get to that point where I need help. And so you can imagine as the lad pulled him in, he goes, put me in between the pillars. And you can still imagine people like, ha-ha, throwing tomatoes or cabbage or whatever it is. And they put him in the middle, and he feels it. And you can imagine maybe stoops down and just like, God, I need help. I can't do this on my own. Please give me strength this one last time, so that I can avenge the Philistines. That you set me apart for a reason even before I was born, that I can do what you set me out to do. And as it says, everybody's seen the pictures where he just pulls down the pillars and everybody dies. We have to get to a point where we can't imagine doing everything on our own. Just like when I was younger and I was trying to pick up that really heavy corner post, and I could have tried my hardest to get it done by myself, but there had to come a point where I'm like, no, you know what? I can't do this on my own. I need help. And it was like, Dad, I need some help. It's getting too heavy. Am I going to drop it on my foot? I need help over here. Another thing, I was trying to think of another illustration, is the Titanic. I was reading things, and they were told from a way before they hit the iceberg that there were icebergs ahead, and they knew, hey, there's something coming. But they're like, ah, it's not that big a deal because we're the unsinkable ship. We can do whatever. Not even God can sink us. And with that, they hit the iceberg, and then the famous SOS went out. Save our souls. We need help. But for them, it was too late. How many times in our life have we done almost the same exact thing where we mess up? Where God has set us apart to do something in our lives, but unfortunately we fail. And then we have to get to the point where we have to be like, God, please, I need help. We have to humble ourselves, and then we have to ask God for, again, we have to go to him. It's very humbling to go to God and say, God, I can't do this by myself. I need your help. So What are some things that can help you to not get to the point where you fail and where you have to restore the help from God? First of all, we need to have a personal relationship with God, have a consistent walk with God. It's a daily relationship with God. It's reading your Bible, praying to God. I'm preaching to the Wednesday night crowd. Everybody knows that. Everybody knows, hey, we're supposed to read our Bible. But how many times do we fail? I know I fail all the time. Then we need to stay focused on what God has put in our life. Just like God set Samson apart even before he was born, and he told his parents, This is what Samson I have set out for his life. Even though Samson, he got off track, we need to stay focused on what God has for us. Don't be like Samson and wander off, just like Samson wandered off to Gaza in the Valley of Sorek, where he put himself in positions to fail. How many times in our life were, I know I have, when we do something, I'm not supposed to say this word, stupid, that in the end we're like, you know what, why did I do that? And you can maybe imagine Samson was like that. You're like, why did I do that? God put us here for a reason and a purpose, just like Samson, so that we can fulfill God's purpose in our life. Just like Samson in our life, we can learn something. We're not gonna free a country from the Philistines, but we can help a church grow. Even though Samson tried to do everything by himself, we can't do everything in our lives by ourselves. We can't get through temptations by ourselves. God wants to have that relationship with us so we can get help from him. I've got some questions for you tonight. Who do you go to for help? Do you try to do everything by yourself, just like Samson when the Philistines came upon him with the jawbone of the donkey? He didn't go to God and say, hey, I need help right now. He was like, I'm going to pick up this jawbone of a donkey. And even though that was against his set of rules that God gave him, he still did it. I do this to myself all the time. Do you put yourself in positions to fail? How many times I have in my life that we put ourselves in a position and we know pretty much from the beginning, and you're just like, you know what? I'm not going to worry about what the consequences are. I'm just going to do it. And then in the end, you're like, that was stupid. Lastly, do you rely on God to lift you up in your time of trouble? Or still in the end, I know I can be sometimes also, are you so stubborn? Are we so stubborn that we're like, you know what? I got myself into this position. Let me get out myself. That's not what God wants for us. He wants us to be there. He wants to help us. He doesn't want us to try to do everything on our own. Where are you tonight? I hope that you're not living your life like Samson, where you're constantly failing and not restoring what God wants to do in your life. He wants to help you. He doesn't want you to do this on your own. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for the day you've given to us. I just thank you so much for the opportunity to preach tonight. I pray that you would help us and guide us in our life so that we will not fail, that we could understand what we're doing in our lives. I just Thank you again for the opportunity to preach tonight. Work in our hearts, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to have a time of meditation and reflection on what we've heard, but a couple of thoughts that I jotted down tonight. I want to say this. Aren't you thankful that God helps people who can't help themselves? Like, have you ever heard that statement before? Well, you know, God helps those that help themselves. Now, I think there's a measure of truth to that, right? I mean, we do have to have some human effort, and God helps us in that respect. And so that balance between God's power and man's responsibility, that's an eternal, you know, kind of question. But the truth of the matter is God does help people who cannot help themselves. And if that wasn't true, none of us in this room would be saved. And so I'm thankful that God helps people that even put themselves in bad situations. All the way back to the Garden of Eden. Adam, where are you? He had put himself in a terrible situation, and God reached out to him and helped him. We ought to thank God for that tonight. Because we've been like Samson, blind, messed up, imprisoned, in a mess, and it was all our own doing. But that second thought that he gave, that's an interesting one, isn't it? Are we humble enough to seek after God? A lot of times we're in a mess of our own making, and we say, well, you know, I got myself in it, I'll get myself out of it, and we make a bigger mess. So we have to humble ourselves. We've asked the Lord to help us. I don't know what help you need from the Lord tonight. It may just be the everyday help of daily needing the Lord. Without him, we can do nothing. You may be in a mess of your own making tonight. You may be in a situation that there is no solution other than God. Whatever it is, let's talk to the Lord a little bit tonight and reflect on these thoughts. So as Mrs. Bales plays, let's talk to the Lord for a few minutes. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the example of Samson in the Bible. Thank you for Aaron and the message that we heard tonight. We want to thank you specifically that you have helped us when we could not help ourselves. You have gotten us out of messes that we made, and you have even worked with us in the midst of our own pride. And we just thank you for how gracious and good and caring and helpful that you are. Lord, teach us to humble ourselves. We know that you resist the proud, and we must be humble enough to seek after you. And I think of that question that he asked, who do we go to for help? May it always be you. Teach us not to lean to our own understanding, but in all our ways acknowledge you, and you will direct our paths. We praise you for this. We ask you for this, and it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I want to say a few things, if I could, just pastorally tonight. You know, standing in front of people and preaching is not as easy as you might think it is. And the Word of God is a serious responsibility to it. And, you know, I didn't mean to make you feel nervous. I gave you a heads up. I thought it would be better to tell you than just to show up. But again, I'm thankful for anybody that is learning how to carefully exposit the scriptures and apply the scriptures. It is a lifelong challenge, and I'm thankful. for the privilege and opportunity to do that, and for even young men that are doing that. Now, let me say something to Oakwood Baptist Church. This is the first summer since I've been here that we've had an intern. I would like to see us do this more often. I think for a variety of reasons. One, I'd like to see God call more preachers in the ministry, even from our own ministry. Now, I've said this publicly in church. I've said it in high school chapel. I don't think every young person goes into ministry. I don't think God calls that way. But I do believe that in our church, we want to challenge our young people to at least consider it. We ought to be asking God, is that what you want of me? And if God says yes, then do it. It's great. If God says no, that's not what I want for you, then what he has for you is great. So do that. Success in life is finding what God wants you to do and doing that. And I would like to see God call preachers and missionaries over the years out of Oakwood Baptist Church. We should be reproducing ourselves and leaving something behind. That's important. And so that being said, if we can have some young man in a Bible college that would come and serve in our ministry, even though they're not necessarily from our ministry, I think it's a wonderful opportunity for them to be a blessing to us, but it's also a wonderful opportunity for us to be a blessing to them. And I would love to see the fingerprints of Oakwood Baptist Church on a variety of young men all over the country that we could be a blessing to and teach some things along the way. Because I can promise you this, I went to a good Bible college, but there were so many things that they did not teach me in a classroom that I had to learn when I got out. And sometimes I had to learn them the hard way. And if we can help with some of those practical nuts and bolts, we want to do that. And so again, I don't see it as any kind of expense. I see it as an investment in others. And so with that in mind, be in prayer. Maybe you want to be a blessing to Brother Aaron on Sunday. We'll do that after the evening service on Sunday night. And we'll just try and be a little bit of a help to him as he's been a blessing to us. I hate it that we weren't more normal, that we could have got to know him a little better. But excellent spirit, and we've been glad to have him this summer. So again, I appreciate that. Well, let's stand together and we'll be dismissed. We'll pray very briefly again and we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, again, we love you. Thank you for being such a good God to us. And help us as we go our separate ways this evening. Keep us safe and in your care. Be with those that were not able to be with us tonight, that are at home watching on live stream. Encourage their hearts. Bring us back together on Sunday. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.